All right. So the challenge for now is to present you with a programming language in 12 minutes. So, first, the motivation. If we focus on the G of AGI, we must come with the conclusion that it's not only the domain independence with regards to the task and inputs to be processed by the system, but it's also a question of scalability. Scalability in terms of complexity of the construction of the system itself. Natural intelligence are not that general and not that powerful. So we face sooner than later the question of managing the complexity. We follow what we tend to call a constructivist approach. It means to delegate to the system part of the construction of itself. So I will briefly present you with a programming language that has been used to implement an actual system. It's a system that learns socio-communicative skills by observing people. All right, so what are the main characteristics of the learning language? It's based on a non-axiomatic logic. It means, in fact, that it's real, valued, and is constrained in time. The whole system is data driven, so you don't query things. The inputs come to executable codes, and the patterns are matched or not, and depending on that, some production are done. All the code is stateless, meaning in fact that this is used to allow introspection. When you don't have state inside code, it's easier for some other piece of code to analyze the semantics of the former one. You won't find if loops or control structures like that, because the language has its own ways to deal with that. It's all relying on massive parallelism. It means, in fact, that pattern matching is done concurrently over a huge set of executable code that can be scattered on platform from a laptop to a full cluster of computers. What is worth noticing also is that code can be activated or not, depending on some real valued control schemes, actually. So it's a kind of functional language. It looks like Lisp, but don't look too close. We know now that the code can be activated or not, but also inputs can be salient or not. So in fact, for an input to be processed by a piece of code, it must be salient enough, and the piece of code must be active enough. There is no on-the-fly modification of data or code once produced. An object can be changed. It has a limited lifespan. And all of those objects, they live in groups, what we call groups actually. They are workspaces used to segment or partition, if you like, the knowledge that you will find in a system. Okay, now I will go to the crux of the whole thing. There is some learning abilities, there is some planning abilities, there is some systems to focus the attention. I won't have the time to present them now. So I will focus exclusively now on what the system does once it has acquired the knowledge. So a system is basically the collection of models. What is a model? It's a piece of executable code, some kind of procedural knowledge, if you'd like, that captures causal relationships. Okay. Like A indexes B. Once you have that, you can also use the exact same piece of code to perform some abduction, like if I want a bee, it's not a bad idea to look for an A. Okay, those two fundamental operations, deduction and abduction, are processed simultaneously, concurrently, by the same exact piece of code. This is of extreme importance, because we are targeting the construction of control systems. So we cannot produce goals if we don't have the predictions of the state of the thing that has to be controlled, right? Because if we did that, then we will always lag behind the plant. So we must be able to set goal while keeping in mind the ongoing flow of predictions, and symmetrically, while we produce predictions, we must be aware of our goals in order to meet them and not to run after a ball that is coming right in your face and you just have to wait. So, okay, you can see here and there that all of those terms here contains variables. What I didn't draw here is that those functions here contains guards. What is a guard? A guard is a set of equations. So what we have in Fine is not only a term on the left side that entails a term on the right side, but it also contains some equations. And those equations are reversible. When I compute B from A, we have a set of equations here that bind those variables here, and some of them are not here, see? And we have a set of reverse equations to perform the same thing the other way around. Also, all of that works in real time. It means that when I predict a B here, it means the fact that I fork a thread to check in due time if the prediction has come true or not. This is of importance because the success of a model will be assessed by its performance in predicting. Okay, so here in shorthand, I have a set of models here, see? So what I want to talk about now is indirect coupling. You can see that there is no wires between things here, absolutely none. It makes it really easy for the system to add and remove things. Okay, so what you get here is A entails B. B will match there, and produce a C here that will match here, and eventually produce a D here. So in fact, you have a graph of pattern affordances. It's a control hierarchy. The language is fully reflective. It means, in fact, that whenever a piece of code is executed, this gives birth to a first-class input. It means, in fact, that when this receives an instance of A and predicts a B there, then the system automatically injects an instance of that. This is fundamental because it allows the system to treat its own operation as an input. Why is it important? Because if it can see what it is doing, since it can learn about things, it can also learn about what it is doing. It means, in fact, that this gives the possibility for the system to model itself. All right, so we'll be quick now. All of those ways here are ways to encode preconditions. It means, in fact, that the model here, like the first two, M1 and M2 here, are controlling somehow the execution of the first one. And we have seen the control, well, the preconditions, but now the system also has to know what is the context for a good execution of a model. In other terms, the system must be able to model the consequences of its own acts. That's being done by what we call post-conditions. So here, for example, this reads, when M0 fires with a set of parameters, of course, then it enters C. So at the end of the day, we have, in fact, a full control hierarchy, which is, in fact, a three-dimensional. Here, of course, it's only 1D, but the first dimension is pattern affordances, the second one is post-condition, the third one is preconditions. This, yes, could have written the other way around. This is the interface to the world, and those are the innate drives, the motivational system of the entity. So, what is also important, we are based on real valued logic. One of these key elements is what we call confidence. So each term in the system has a confidence. What is a confidence? It's not a probability, absolutely not. It's the likelihood of the occurrence of the thing. And this, of course, is subjected to different interpretations. For example, the confidence of a prediction means, in fact, the likelihood for the prediction to become true. The confidence of a goal is the likelihood of the goal to be achieved. Okay? So, simple equations like this one means, in fact, when a model produces a prediction, the confidence of said prediction is the confidence of the input multiplied by the success rate of the model, and symmetrically for goals. What does that really mean? It means this. It means that, say here, I have weak models. It means, in fact, models that run once in a while. They are not that strong. And those ones are really strong. It means, in fact, that most of the time, they are right in predicting things. So, I get some inputs from here, from this environment. And of course, depending on the affordances and patterns, it flows up there. So of course, at some point here, since the confidence is multiplied across the traversal of the graph, there you will end up with a very weak one. But once a confidence gets under a threshold, the thing that carries it is not examined anymore. So it means, in fact, that this will not get further up. On the other hand, this path is much stronger. What does that finally mean? It means, in fact, that generally, only the best known way to predict things will be used, while leaving the chance for the weak ways to improve. Okay, so we have seen this flow. I didn't talk much about that. What are those? Those are drives. Drives are non-observable states, actually. It's a set of goals that the programmer will give to the system. It means, in fact, is the definition of its mission, what to do and what not to do as well. This comes along with a set of what we call here top-level models. Those are defined and coded ways to achieve those drives. So those will not change, but these will change by the means of learning. Okay, so we have seen the control hierarchy. We will add a fourth dimension, which we call the structural hierarchy. In the form of composite states. It means, in fact, it's just a conjunction of individual states, composites or not. Those A, B, and C that form this state must be in synchronicity. What does that mean? With regards to the logic that we use, which is also a temporal logic, A, B, and C are set synchronous if they hold within a common small enough interval of time. So, what to remember about all of that, all the models are coupled, but they are not hardwired. So it's indirect coupling. This comes from the matching ability of the language. The control hierarchy is three-dimensional, the affordances, precondition, postconditions. The fourth dimension can be added is the structural hierarchy. It means, in fact, it forms the hierarchy of concepts, actually. And since the language is fully operational, it means, in fact, that every piece of knowledge does not describe things. It describes the effects of things. So each piece of knowledge is actually a piece of executable code. It means that the concepts that we use here are fully operational. For example, the system will not describe the physical properties of a hat, but will describe instead the consequences of wearing a hat, or to produce a hat, or steal a hat, or whatever. But not, so the system is incapable of representing some knowledge which is not grounded in actions. And a last word about the logic, very quickly. So the confidence, as I said, is not a probability, no? Since the sum of the confidences over a distribution can never be equal to one. This is a constraint that is that we have to acknowledge thanks to the assumption of insufficient resources. The logic is time constrained. It means that things hold in an interval here. And the executive of the language, mean by that the virtual machine that interprets all of that, has built-in fixed inference rules that drive the deduction, abduction, induction, commitment, and more. Those are fixed. It means, in fact, that nowadays the system is not capable to changing its own inferencing rules. All right, I think I'm done. Thank you.
No? Do you have questions? No? Okay, thank you very much.